Practice Test 1. Page 8, Section 2. Repeat sentence. You will hear some sentences. Please repeat each sentence exactly as you hear it. You will hear each sentence only once.
Please come to the next seminar properly prepared.
You'll find the economics section on the second floor of the library.
Next time, we'll discuss the influence of the media on public policy.
There is plenty of cheap accommodation off campus.
The lecture on child psychology has been postponed until Friday.
The meeting will take place in the main auditorium.
You must establish a day and a time with your tutor.
There will be no extensions given for this project.
New timetables will be posted on the student notice board.
All students are encouraged to vote in the forthcoming elections.
Practice Test 1, page 14, section 2. Retell lecture. You will hear a lecture. After listening to the lecture, please retell what you have just heard from the lecture in your own words. You will have 40 seconds to give your response. Lecture A.
So, continuing our series of lectures on modernism, we now turn to architecture, and in particular to the work of Frank O. Gehry. Now, I'm not going to go into his career in detail. It is enough to say that early on, he was, like other modernist architects, tied to the rectangle, the straight line, and so on. Often their buildings would have this basic shape, and they would just add bits of decoration, like splashes of color or pointless balconies. Soon enough, Gehry wanted to break away from straight lines and grid-like designs. He wanted the freedom to experiment with other shapes, curves, and unusually angled roofs. What helped him with this was the computer, which allowed him to visualize and experiment with complex shapes and to work on the whole design as one piece, without the added decoration being thrown in as an afterthought. Architecture as art, if you like. Or sculpture, even. He himself said that he had struggled with crossing the line between architecture and sculpture. Now, I want to talk about one building in particular, the Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao, which I think you'll agree is a masterpiece.
Lecture B.
Now, you might think it's strange that in a lecture on biology, I'll be talking a lot about mathematics. If I may digress a bit, when I was a student, mathematics, the language of clear abstraction, had nothing to do with life sciences like biology, the sphere of messy organic forms, cutting up frogs in the lab and so on. In fact, I started doing biology precisely to avoid maths and physics. So, I've had a lot of catching up to do. We are all aware of how the sciences have come to interrelate more and more, and not only will mathematics impinge more and more on biology, but also, I am told, in the 21st century, the driving force behind mathematics will be biology. This is partly because mathematicians are always on the lookout for more areas to conquer. But a far greater reason is that the subject has been boiled down to physics and chemistry. Obvious attractions for mathematicians. A number of mathematical fields can be applied to biology. For example, knot theory is used in the analysis of the tangled strands of DNA, and abstract geometry in four or more dimensions is used to tell us about viruses. Again, neuroscience appears to be maths-friendly, and equations can also explain why hallucinogenic drugs cause the users to see spirals. So, if mathematicians are taking such a keen interest in biology, the least we can do as biologists is return the compliment.
Lecture C.
Most of what the general public knows about daily life in ancient Rome comes from art, architecture, and literature, which tell us more about the elites, especially the goings-on of the emperors. But how much do we know of the lives of ordinary Romans? Did they have a voice? Apart, that is, from what we can gather from graffiti. The usual picture is one of time spent at festivals, baths, and typically the games. However, for many Romans, terrible living conditions, poverty, debt, and the chance of being sold into slavery at any moment, that is, if they weren't slaves already, left no time or energy for such forms of entertainment, or for any interest in politics, for that matter. Indeed, after the death of Augustus, executive power was taken from the elected assemblies of the Roman people. Now it was the emperor's job to look after the people, and his generosity often depended on the mood and behaviour of the people, on how often and how violently they protested and rioted. One example would be Claudius ensuring a steady grain supply, even in winter, after rioters pelted him with stale crusts of bread. There is an anecdote about Hadrian. While touring the provinces, an old lady approached him with a complaint. He made excuses and tried to get away. She said that if he wouldn't give her a hearing, he shouldn't be emperor. She got her hearing.
Practice Test 1, page 14, section 2. Answer short question. You will hear some questions. Please give a simple and short answer to each one. Often just one or a few words is enough.
Which section of a newspaper gives the editor's opinion?
What instrument would you use to examine very small objects or life forms?
What is a destructive program that spreads from computer to computer?
What term is used for animals such as humans that usually give birth to live young, mammals or reptiles?
What do you call a system of government in which people vote for the people who will represent them?
What do we call the piece of paper that proves you have bought an item?
What do you call the document that gives details about your qualifications and work experience?
How would you describe an economy based largely on farming?
What is the study of the stars and planets called?
In business and advertising, what does PR stand for?
Practice Test 1, page 10, section 2. Describe image. Model answers. Image A.
This pie chart shows where people get the news from. The largest number, 40%, get the news from the television. But this is closely followed by newspapers, which are used by 36%. It seems surprising that the internet comes third, with only 15% of people getting the news from there. Finally, only 9% get the news from other sources.
Image B.
This graph shows the unemployment rate amongst people of different ages from 1992 to 2010. The rates for people aged 16 to 17 were the highest over the whole period, reaching 45% in 2009 and 2010. Between 1992 and 1995, the unemployment level for those aged 18 to 20 was about 25%, then dropped below 20% until 2008, when they continued to rise, reaching 27 to 28% in 2010. The levels of unemployment for those aged between 21 to 24, both with and without a degree, followed a similar pattern, beginning at about 15% in 1992 and ending at about 12% and 14%, respectively, in 2010. But apart from a period from about 1993 to 6, the level of unemployment was higher for those without a degree.
Image C.
This bar graph shows how many tons of carbon dioxide were emitted by residents in various places. The lowest figure is for London, where only about 6 tons were emitted by each resident. The northeast was by far the worst, with about 12 tons of CO2 emissions per resident. It was followed by Yorkshire and the Humber with approximately 9.5 tonnes per resident. Residents of all other regions emitted between about 7 and 8 tonnes of CO2 in 2008.
Image D.
This bar graph shows the growth in the number of households with internet access over the 4-year period from 2006 to 2009. Growth has been fairly steady over the period shown, at around 4 or 5% each year. According to the graph, about 70% of households had internet access by 2009. This compares to only about 57% in 2006.
Image E.
Two things are illustrated by this graph, which covers a 20-year period, running from 1989 until 2009. The number of overseas visitors to the UK and the number of UK residents going abroad. Both show steady growth until about 2008, although there was a slight dip in the number of overseas visitors to the UK between 2001 and 2002. In 2008, both types of travel dropped, with a particularly sharp decrease in the number of UK residents going abroad. Generally, throughout this period, more people from the UK went abroad than there were visitors to the UK.
Image F.
This demographic graph breaks down the estimated population of the UK in 2010 by age and gender. The largest age group consists of men and women in their early 40s. Other large age groups in both sexes are the 20 to 30 age group and the early 60s. Up until the 70s, the numbers of men and women remain fairly equal, but then in old age, women outnumber men. It seems surprising that there are not more children and young people in the UK population today.
Practice Test 1, page 14, section 2. Retell lecture. Model answers. Lecture A.
The general topic of the lecture is modernism and architecture, but the speaker focuses on the work of modernist architect Frank Gehry, in particular the Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao. Geary wanted to break away from the usual straight-line designs of other architects and experiment with other shapes, especially curves. He thought of architecture as an art like sculpture, and the museum is a brilliant example of his art.
Lecture B.
The main point of the lecture is how various sciences can come together to enrich each other, in particular here, mathematics and biology. The speaker talks first about their personal experience of school and choosing to study biology to avoid doing maths or subjects like it, but explains that maths has a lot to contribute to biology. The speaker then gives two examples. The first is the use of knot theory to analyse DNA. The second is using abstract geometry to study viruses.
Lecture C.
The lecture is about daily life in ancient Rome. The speaker says that what we know is mostly about the aristocracy, but we know much less about the lives of ordinary people and how much say they had politically and socially. Most people lived very difficult lives. The speaker points out that it was the duty of the emperor to take care of ordinary people. He gives the examples of Claudius and Hadrian, both of whom had to be reminded of their duty.